God make you drool just like pasta fossil. That's amore.
That's amore.
When you dance down the street with the club at your feet, you're in love. When you walk in a dream, but you know you're not dreaming, signore. Excuse me, but you see, back in old Napoli, that's amore.
Amore,
that's amore.
All right, well, welcome everyone. Who's ready to go get some Italian food, huh? Just makes you want to eat something real good, real close to Italian. Just for some reason, watching that makes me think of a restaurant my wife and I like to go to called North Italia, which is obviously not in Italy. It's actually here in Houston. So if you're just looking for an Italian restaurant, there you go. That one's for free. And we're going to be tonight continuing in our message series. We just kicked off Romans last week. And today we're going to be continuing that, talking about to roam with love, specifically talking about being connected together. There's something special, isn't there, when we get to be connected together with friends, with family, having shared experiences. I'm thinking about all the times, like I love going to movies with friends. And I know there's some people who like going movies by themselves, and that's great, good for you. But like, I don't like to do that. I got to be with someone because I want to talk about it. I want to unpack it. I want to get their thoughts and their feelings about the movie. And so being connected together in those moments is special. It might be family gatherings and you're just getting to see each other. There is something meaningful, something really particularly powerful when we get to be together. And what we're going to get to see in the book of Romans is Paul's heart for Rome, that he wants to be with them. And he wants something deep when they get to connect together. And so if you got a Bible with you, I want you to turn to Romans chapter 1 is where we're going to be at. We're going to be in verse 8. So Romans chapter 1, verse 8. And as we think about being connected together, it made me think about our culture and society. And I'm not going to try to be the person who's constantly ragging on social media and dogging on it. But at the same time, let's look and see where we're kind of at as a society. That we might be highly connected with social media and with our mobile devices and with our phones, but a lot of times we find ourselves being relationally distanced. There's an article from an Oxford University professor in psychology, which means he's super smart, and he researched that on Facebook that most people have approximately 150 friends. But out of those 150 friends, only 15 of them could be considered genuine friendships, and then only 5 out of 150 would be considered close friends. And that's a paradox, isn't that? We're super connected. All sorts of mediums and media that is going to connect us together, and yet we're also very distanced. And that distance, I'm going to just spoiler alert, is a lack of depth that we have in those relationships. Specifically, and the article continued on, it said, for the generation born with a device in their hand, so looking at 18 to 24-year-olds, they're 4 times more likely to feel lonely most of the time versus those who are 70 and older. And that's not to rag on the younger generation. That's just to say that maybe this whole social media experience isn't actually making us closer together. In fact, maybe it's an illusion and we're feeling more lonely, more disconnected, more separated. And that's not what we want in our world or society. That's definitely not what we want here at the church and at the Five. And so let's look and see what God's word says, what Paul's going to say to us about having relationships that are connecting together. What I'm going to do tonight is I want to share with us 3 ways to love well, 3 ways to invest well in the relationships that you have in your life presently. And so I hope you're already there. Romans chapter 1, verse 8. Read along with me. It'll also be up on the screens. It says this. It says, first, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, because your faith is proclaimed in all the world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit and the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I mention you always in my prayers, asking that somehow, by God's will, I may now at last succeed and coming to you. And so we see Paul's heart here so clear, his longing to be with the people in Rome. He hasn't been to Rome yet. He's writing this letter from Corinth in around 57 AD, but his heart is overflowing with gratitude and longing to be with them face to face. And the first point in your message guide is this: be grateful for the depths, not just the surface, right? Be grateful for the things of the heart. Be grateful for the things that are deeper than just superficiality. Look at what he says. He says, I'm thankful to God for you. Why? Because your faith, that's a place of depth. He's saying, I'm grateful for the faith that you're living out, that the church in Rome, he's hearing about the Rome's faith spreading throughout the empire. And he's encouraged by it. And he says, man, I'm so thankful that through Jesus Christ, the gospel is going forth. Be grateful for the depths, not just for the things on the surface. There's a great verse, parents, I encourage you to write this down, to memorize it. 3 John 4, it says this: I have no greater joy than that my children walk with God, and that my children walk in truth. The greatest thing that we can be thankful for is that they're walking with Jesus, that they're living out their faith. And so being grateful and even speaking into the things of faith and the things of the depth, this gratitude for Paul, it stems so clearly from his gratitude for the Lord Jesus and what God is doing with his church all across the Roman Empire, all across the world. And I was just thinking about this faith proclaimed. He says it's proclaimed in all the world. And so I got to connect with our missions team. And I just want to tell you some incredible, incredible things that our church is doing all across the world. That because of your generosity, because of who we are as a church, because we don't want to be a church that's just ministering to Houston. We want a church like Rome that says our faith is being proclaimed in all of the world. I want to share with you some stats that are going to be just like, whoa, you won't believe what God is doing through a tiny little church. We can say that in a global sense, through a small church in Houston with a lot of hot, heat, mosquitoes. God is using us globally. So here's what I want to do. I'm going to share these. I want you to hold your enthusiasm. You're going to be like, whoa, that's cool. I'm going to clap. Hold it in. If you let it, that's okay. But at the very end, I'm gonna point to you and we're all gonna go crazy, all right? So here's some things that's happening in our church here at Houston's First because of God's people responding to the gospel. Did you know that we support over 100 plus missionary units all across the world? 100 plus missionaries are funded and supported and cared for. We have a whole department called Missionary Care because we wanna not just fund our missionaries, we wanna care for them. We want to walk beside them. We want to know how we can come and be a blessing to them. 100 plus missionaries that we are supporting. We are involved with all of our missionary partners with 45 plus countries. That's how many places that our church has a footprint on because of our global impact. As a church this year, we've sent out 12 mission trip teams. I got to be a part of one of them. We've been to Costa Rica, South Asia, Brazil, and Mexico. And I'm just super excited to leak something to you guys. We're planning right now a mission trip specifically for the five to go to South Asia next summer. So I just want to leak it for you. Just want you to let you stew on it. We're going to be taking a team from the five specifically to go to South Asia to share the gospel because we want to be a church that's ministering to Houston, ministering to a nation, and then ministering all around the world. A couple more for you. With Kainos, we've been helping translate the Bible in 25 plus languages. I mean, think about how many Bibles you have. I probably have a couple dozen Bibles laying around. I got tons of them. But there's some people who don't have the Bible in their native tongue or language or even be able to hear auditorily. And so we're helping in some way, form, or fashion, 25 plus languages, getting the Bible with them. Two more, I promise. Last one, these are, I think, the coolest ones. This year, in June 2022, we closed out our fiscal year budget. And looking back at all of 2021 into 2022, in our budget percentage-wise, with our commission, which is what we say is all of our money that's going out the door towards missions, 17.8% was 100% going towards missions endeavors. And then last but not least, this is the one we're gonna get to wrapped on, in total, including not just missions office money, but all of our budgets across all of our campuses, 28.17% of our expenditures are going towards missions all around the world. Can we applaud what God is doing through our church? That's amazing. Because why? Because our faith is being proclaimed around the world. That's being grateful for faith. That's being grateful for the depths. And that's what we want to be about here at the Five and at Houston's First. So here, let me get it practical for us. Okay, we just want to brag on our church, want to brag on our people, brag on the generosity of Houston's First, each of you guys in this room. And we don't want to just be grateful for what we've done. We want to be grateful for the people in our lives. We want to put gratitude into practice. And so I want to give you three things that are going to help you just very put this into practice. The first thing is this: make gratitude a priority, okay? Make it a priority. Look at what Paul says. He says, first, I thank my God. And that's crazy because Paul's gonna have a lot of theology he wants to tell him. He wants to get into justification and sanctification and glorification and all sorts of amazing theologies, but he starts and he says, but first, I thank my God through Jesus Christ. And he makes it a priority. Because if you don't make it a priority, what we all know is it's not going to come to fruition, is it? There's a great quote from Elizabeth Elliot, and she said this: it is always possible to be thankful for what is rather than to complain about what is not given. One or the other becomes a habit of life. You know, I found that we don't have to teach people how to complain, right? Like, I don't have to teach someone, like, hey, let me tell you how to complain. You look for a problem. You get real bubbled up about it, and then you overflow with complaints and disgruntledness and being displeased. Like, we don't have to teach people how to do that. It comes pretty naturally, doesn't it? What we do have to do is teach people how to be thankful, how to be grateful from our hearts, how to be grateful for the Lord, for the things that he is doing. And so we need to make it a priority to choose gratitude. Second thing is this: make it personal. Make it personal. It says, first, I thank my God for you. And then he goes on, he says, because of your faith, right? Because of your faith, that's personal. And he goes on to share what their faith was doing, going around the world. But we got to make it personal. Listen, I want to encourage us in our thank yous with one another. This isn't just saying, oh yeah, just say thank you to as many people as possible. Just real casual thank yous, because that's not what we want to be about. We want to be about sincerity. We want to be about the depths. And so to be a personal thank you, and the way I wanted you to think about it is when you say thank you to someone, say, I'm thankful because you fill in the blank. Like, what are you specifically thankful for that they've done? Man, I'm thankful that you have come through for me, that you were there for me and present. I'm thankful that you were serving in this capacity. Like, what if in our marriages we were doing this as a priority and personal? Just, man, I'm so thankful for my spouse, for the way that they have taken care of the home, the way that they've provided for the family, the way that they've loved one another, that we would be thankful in a way that is personal. Go deeper than just a Hallmark pre-written thank you card, right? Make it personal. And then the last, and definitely the most important, make it happen. Like, at the end of the day, we got to make it happen. Paul tells the people in Rome of his gratefulness. And I want to encourage us to be the people who actually follow through with it. A lot of us have good intentions, don't we? Like, oh, I really intended to take time to write that out. Like, I intended to express to you my gratitude, but let's not be the good intentions generation. Let's not be a good intentioned church. Let's be a church that's gonna make gratitude happen, that actually puts it into practice. William Arthur Ward, he said this. He said, God gave you a gift of 86,400 seconds. Have you used one of them to say thank you? Right? Have we used the time that God has given us to express our gratitude to people? Now, here's how we're going to make this even easier for you, is if it's not simple enough just to write out a thank you letter, and my life has been so saturated by thank you letters from my parents, from people close to me, and those are always so meaningful, isn't it, to receive a thank you letter. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to help you do it. We're going to help you make it happen. We are going to have some thank you notes that are, I've got some pre-written stuff on it, plenty of space for you to customize it and make it personal. And these are going to be in your Life Bible studies if you're in Life Bible study, or we're going to have these out in the main lobby foyer that you can grab. And I want to encourage you, take time to make it happen and to write a thank you letter to a spouse, to a friend, to a family member, to a coworker. Hey, surprise someone who doesn't know Jesus with gratitude overflowing for what they've meant to you in their life. And let that be a ministry. Let God use that to be an impact for them. And how cool would it be if at the five, it's just like a sending out of gratitude, that there's several hundred people who are gonna receive thank you letters in Jesus' name because of what God's word calls us to do. So let's be grateful for the depths. Let's make it happen. It's gonna be an amazing thing. Now let's continue in Romans chapter 1 and see what else Paul wants to speak to us about how to love and to care for one another. Well, I wanna pick back up in verse 9 and read through verse 10. He says, "For God is my witness, who I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his son, that without ceasing I mention you always in my prayers, asking that somehow by God's will, I may at last succeed in coming to you." The last thing that we see, or the thing that we see here in this passage, is to be prayerful for and with the people in your life. That we'd be prayerful. And what I want to encourage us is if we are going to say, "Hey, I'm praying for you," let me give you a real simple challenge. Pray for them. Right? Like one of the worst Christian passing by things is like, "Oh yeah, I'll pray for you." As if it's like a salutation, you know? Like, "See you later, pray for you," you know, XOXO. Man, when we say we're gonna pray for people, let's be a church that prays. That says, "You know, I'm going to take your prayer request, and I'm gonna bring it to my God." Here's what praying for people signifies. Praying for people is you saying, "I don't have the answer. I don't have the solution to the problem, to the circumstances, to the situation, to whatever it is." It's actually a humble admission of like, "I really got nothing for you. But let me tell you who does. My God does. Because he's powerful, because he's all wise, he's all knowing, and because he loves you." And so when you're praying for someone, with someone, you're saying, "I'm gonna bring your situation to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I believe that he's going to hear. And I believe that when as it's within his will and his desire, he's gonna come through, he's gonna meet your needs." And so praying for people, praying with people, it's a powerful, powerful thing for us to be able to do. I think it's the greatest way for us to care for people in our lives, that we would be able to say, as Paul does, that we are praying for people in our lives. I was thinking about a mission trip I had been on a couple years ago to Cambodia, and as a team, we were working with this missionary. He's just an amazing man, great brother and friend of mine, and before we left, we wanted to pray over him because he's doing the work of ministry. He's a missionary. A lot of times, missionaries are very isolated. There's loneliness because they're reaching the unreached. So there's not like a bunch of churches or Christians surrounding them. And so we said, "Hey, we want to pray for you." So we put him in the middle. We said, "Hey, we want to lay hands on you." There's nothing particularly special, if you will, about laying on of hands, except that it's just powerful to feel touch, to know that people love you in that way. And so we put our hands on him. We prayed for him. And at the end of the prayer, we said, "Amen." And he's just weeping. And he's got these tears rolling down his face. We said, "Hey, what's going on, brother?" Thought maybe we had said something or something was stirring up. And he said, "Man, that's the first time that I've had hands laid on me in prayer in over a year." It was powerful for him. Why? Because it said, "Man, we love you. We care for you. We believe in your ministry. We're praying that God's going to do your work." And just the laying on of hands, it is something really powerful. So yes, pray for people, but I also really want to encourage us, like, pray with people. And if you feel like it's a little awkward to do that, can I just say it's a great thing to be awkward about prayer? Like, if we're gonna be awkward about anything relationally, let's be awkward with being prayerful. Not being awkward with conversation, not being awkward with just an off-the-cuff comment, but like risk being awkward and say, "Hey, can I pray for you right now?" Like, a practice I try to put into my life is when someone mentions a prayer request, like, I'm gonna pray for them in that moment. I do that because, number one, incredibly forgetful. Like, your boy will forget the request if I don't write it down in particular. And so if someone says, "Hey, this is going on in my life," I'm saying, "Let me pray for you right now." Because then I'm saying, when I pray for you, I'm praying for you in the moment, right? If you get an opportunity to do that, do that. Yesterday, I was on a phone call with someone that is just going through incredibly deep, difficult time. And just sharing that with me. And I recognize, like, I got no wisdom. I got no advice. I'm not going to do any of the Christian cheesy, like, it's going to be okay. There's going to be light at the end of the tunnel. Like, that's not helpful for people when they're walking through the depths, right? And so I said, hey, I just said this exactly. I said, I have nothing really to offer you except know that I'm so broken for you. And if it's okay with you, I'd love to pray for you. The person said, yes, of course, and pray for them. And it's a great thing. And so pray for people in the moment. One of the things I do, like a life hack for you, this is free. I like to use Siri or like on the message of iPhone, I like to use the dictation. And if someone, you know, I'll text someone, hey, how can we pray for you? And they pray, they send something back. Well, I'm just going to pray like out loud wherever I'm at and send it out. Not because there's anything even remarkably holy about that, but I'm just going to do it in the moment. So sometimes you'll see me like walking and I'm like talking to my phone. I'm either sending a message or praying for someone or both, right? But then here's the thing I want to encourage you to do. Check what Siri puts. Because there's been so many times I don't know how what I said got sent. And then I had to be like hey, I was just praying for you, but like it really went weird. And so then that's the real way to make prayer awkward, is just send like the most ridiculous message. And it's like, it was trying to be a prayer for you and you're just supposed to interpret it on your own, right? Check it. But it's a good way to do it. Like send a voice message, do something personal to pray for people in the moment. Paul, we see his heart overflows. He's praying for the people in his life. And church, I just want to encourage us to be prayerful for and with people in your life today. Let's continue in the text. We're going to see a third way that Paul is going to encourage us to love well. We're going to be a grateful people. We're going to be a prayerful people. And then lastly, we're going to see here, we're going to be an impactful people. Look with me, starting in verse 11, and we'll read through the end of verse 15. He says, "For I long to see you." Why? "So that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to strengthen you. That is, that we may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith, both yours and mine. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that I have often intended to come to you." You see his heart, he wants to be with them. "But thus far I've been prevented, in order that I may reap some harvest among you, as well as among the rest of the Gentiles. I am under obligation both to Greeks and to barbarians, both to the wise and to the foolish. So I'm eager to preach the gospel to you also who are in Rome." Last big section that we see from Paul, be grateful, be prayerful, and then lastly, be impactful. That we'd be impactful with our lives, and I'm gonna say be impactful and be impacted with the gospel. Impacted, we see Paul says there's gonna be some mutual encouragement of faith. That yes, I want to seek to impact the people around me, but I also recognize that God's going to use that to impact me. I'm going to be impacted with the message of the gospel. I'm going to be impacted by his grace. I'm going to be impacted and grow from other people in my life. So this isn't Paul saying, "I'm the apostle, I'm going to teach you, and that's how it's going to go." He's like, "I'm going to come to you. I've got some things I want to share with you, and then I know that I'm also going to reap some things too. That I'm going to be impacted as well." Now, as a church, we have three words that we use to share the vision of Houston's First, and it's relevant biblical community. I hope you've heard those words before, that we want to be relevant, now that when you come into this room, that it looks like you're in the 21st century, you know? We want it to feel like we're keeping up with things, that there's a relevance to what we're doing. But we also want to make sure that we're always biblical. And I can promise you, there's never a time that you're going to be here in this room at the Five or any of our services at Houston's First where the Bible's not going to be opened, because we want to center on the Word of God. It's not about the words of man. It's not about my ideas. It's not about the latest trends in culture and society. We're gathering here because we want to center around the Word of God. We want to be relevant. We want to be biblical. And we want to be a community. That we want to do life on life with one another, that we want to be the body of Christ, that we want this to be a place where you get to know people, that you plant your life here, that you have deep roots, if you will. Now, the definition that we have of community in our Make It Your Church orientation book, it says this: providing a place to be authentic, involved, impacted, and impactful. That's what we want to be able to foster here. That's why we have Life Bible studies. That's why they exist, and they're amazing. It's the best thing in the world if you're not involved in one of those. We want to encourage you to do that, that there'd be a community, because in community is where you're impacted and you're also to make an impact wherever you are. So I want to give you three things on impact. How do we make an impact? What does that look like? First thing is this: wherever you are, I want to encourage you to make an impact, have an impact mindset wherever you are. Where God's placed you is where you're supposed to make an impact. Okay, and it's not that you need to wait till you arrive to some magical destination. You make an impact where you are, where God's placed you. But what I think is so interesting about Paul is that we see him longing to be somewhere else, isn't he? He's like, man, I want to be in Rome. Like, I want to be with you guys. Like, that's where I want to be. He had plans to be in Rome, but he was prevented. And what we know about the Apostle Paul is that he was faithfully living on mission, making an impact for the gospel wherever he was. But sometimes we get disappointed, right? We get maybe unmet expectations, and that it doesn't always have the best reactions. And so I want to show us a great video of what happens when our expectations aren't met, when things maybe go a little bit disappointing for us of where we are and what happens. So take a look at this video.
So if it's pink, it's a girl, and if it's blue, it's a boy. What does the letter say?
I'm gonna read.
Open it up. What colour is it?
It's blue.
What does that mean?
It's a boy.
It's a boy. Do you love your little baby brother?
No.
Do you love him a little bit?
No.
Oh. Oh, come on, isn't that good? That is rich right there. Oh man, I love it. It's like, yeah, your little brother. No. Can I submit to us that sometimes we're probably like that whenever God says no? Whenever God says not yet. And it's so interesting, Paul is acknowledging, he's like, I'm praying that somehow by God's will, I want to be with you. Paul wants to be in Rome. God said not yet. Now, ironically for Paul, the way he's going to get to Rome is crazy. He wants to show up as a preacher. He's going to get there as a prisoner. If you flip one page over in your Bible to Acts chapter 27, 28, you get to read the insane journey of Paul, of how he gets to Rome. He's going to get shipwrecked. He's going to be bit by a snake. He's going to be then arriving to Rome as a prisoner. And we see at the end of Acts chapter 28, look at this, where Paul finally makes it to Rome in verse 30. It says he lived there 2 whole years at his own expense, and he welcomed all who came to him, proclaiming the kingdom of God and teaching about the Lord Jesus with all boldness and without hindrance. Paul was impacting people wherever he was, even when it's not exactly where he wanted to be in his heart. And I just want to encourage you, where you are is where God wants you to be. And be faithful in the present. Be faithful with where you are to make an impact for the gospel. And God's going to use that in an amazing way. Second thing I want to encourage you is this. Make an impact with whatever you have. With whatever you have. Look, it says here in verse 11, he says, I long to impart to you some spiritual gift to encourage you. He's saying, I'm going to come and I'm going to bring what God has given me. I'm going to let that be an impact and encouragement to you. I think one of the great lies of the enemy is that we don't have enough. that we think that we're deficient, or we think that our story is a taint on our witness, or we think that we just need more knowledge, we need more this, and I can't share the gospel unless I know every single possible answer to every possible question to the faith. And so we let that be excuse for us to not make an impact. Instead, I want to encourage you, like, whatever you have, that's what God's given you, use it. Let that be an impact. Listen, who you are, your personality, your wiring, your wisdom, your strengths, your gifts, your abilities, God's given you those. Use them to make an impact to the people around you. And then lastly, so we're going to make an impact wherever we are, whatever we have. And then lastly, with whoever you are with. Look with me at verses 14 and 15. He says, I'm under obligation both to Greeks and to barbarians, to the wise and to the fool. And so I'm eager to preach the gospel to you also who are in Rome. Paul is saying, I'm going to preach the gospel to anyone and everyone. Like whoever's around me, they're going to end up hearing the gospel. That's how passionate he is about the gospel. Why? Because the gospel is the greatest news in the world. That's why we're not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Why? It's the power of God for salvation. Because the gospel says that our Father in heaven loves us so much that he sent his one and only Son, Jesus Christ, to live the life that you and I could not live. And he died on that cross, but he rose from the dead 3 days later, and he has ascended into heaven. And we are filled with the Holy Spirit, and we have right relationship with God because of Jesus Christ. And that's a good news that the world needs to hear. And whoever is around you in your life, let's love them enough to tell them the greatest news in the history of the world. Chip Luter, he was a summer speaker for us this past summer, and he said this. He said, who in your life is far from God but near to you? That's your mission field. You want to know where you can make an impact? It's wherever you are, it's whatever you have, and it's whoever is in your life. Who in your life is far from God, but guess what? They're near to you. And so you get to make an impact. You get to share the gospel. You get to ask them, hey, how can I pray for you? You get to ask them, hey, how can I care for you? How can I help you? You get to be the one that sends them a thank you letter. You get the one to make the impact with whoever is in your life. Let me put this whole thing together, sermon in a sentence. Grateful is going to lead towards prayerful. And then prayerful is going to lead towards a life that's impactful. I was thinking of my life and all the many thank you letters, notes that I've received, so many from my parents, from my family, from others, from friends and peers. So there's one in particular I was going through, and I thought, wow, this is just like the perfect summary of this text. And it's a letter from my grandpa. My grandpa was a letter writer of letter writers. In fact, at his funeral, there was a couple hundred people there. The pastor was like, hey, if you've ever received a letter from Buddy Joe Garber, please stand. And every single person without exception stood up. I mean, just that kind of person, just overflowing with gratitude kind of man of God. I have this letter that I saw, and I just want to read it for you. I can translate this because my handwriting is incredibly similar to this. And so here's what it says, and I want you to think about these things: grateful, prayerful, impactful. He says this, a personal note to thank you. Get it personal, watch this, for your thoughtful phone call to us today. And it made our day special for both me and Gigi. And you are special. So that's grateful. And watch this. He continues on. He says, rest assured of our continued prayers for you. Asking God, always asking for God's perfect divine will for you and your life. His will is always best. He's grateful. He's prayerful. And then just look at the impact and the ministry of this letter. He says, my simple and best words to you. Stay close enough to God that you can hear him whisper, for he is always listening 24/7. He did not live in Houston. He did not know KSBJ. That's just from the Lord right there. God listens if anyone didn't know. He says this. He said, your best spent time on planet Earth is on your knees. You can trust me on that. My lifetime experience is Jesus is all I need, and Jesus is all I want, his divine and holy presence. That's a man who's grateful. That's a man who's prayerful. And that's a man who's made a deep impact on my life. That's the kind of person I want to be. I want to be grateful for the people around me. I want to be prayerful for people in my life, and I want to make an impact. And I set the five, like, I want to encourage us. Let's be grateful for people around us. Let's be prayerful for the people who are in our lives. And when we receive requests, maybe we're going to pray for them because we're taking their prayers to the God who listens 24/7. And let's make an impact with the gospel, good news message of Jesus Christ. Father, we come and we just thank you, Lord. We thank you first and foremost for Jesus, our Savior. And his blood shed on the cross allows us to have relationship with God. Lord, we thank you that you love us, that you comfort us. Reveal yourself to us, Lord. Thank you for your grace in our failures, your power in our weakness. And as an overflow of you, God, we want to be grateful to people around us. We want to be prayerful and bring all our lives and other people. We would want to lift them up to you, God. Let us be a church that is known for about prayer. Let us be known amongst our friends and family like that person's a prayer warrior. That person prays. When they say they pray. God, let that be true of us at the five. And Lord, let's make an impact wherever we are, with whatever we have and whoever we're with, that we would be bold, God. Fill us with your spirit of confidence to proclaim the name of Jesus in any and every environment that we are in, God. We ask for your strength, for your power to be able to do that, Lord. Help us to leave this message being hearers and doers of your word, God, and to walk in obedience to you. We thank you, Lord, for this time in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey, thanks for watching. To find out more about Houston's First, you can subscribe to our channel or you can go to houstonsfirst.org.